at Bundy. And you described, as you did for us, page 64 at the top, that having been unable to see the bodies from your original position to a satisfactory degree, Risky took you around Dorothy up the alley and in through the house so you could come out the front door and have a better vantage point at the top of the steps without walking through the blood. Correct?
Yes, sir.
All right. And at the top of page 64, you are talking about that, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Okay. Question, how far would you say you were from where the bodies were located? Answer, I was directly above the female victim, which was probably 3 feet. The male victim would have been 10 feet, 12 feet. Question, all right, and from that vantage point, you first observed the glove that you told us about? Answer, not first, no. Question, when did you first observe it? Answer, we had flashlights. We were looking at the female victim. We looked at the male victim. I noticed the glove when I walked around to the, after I exited the residence the first time and walked around to the side, or the north side, north perimeter of Bundy, of 875 Bundy. There's an iron fence, and through that iron fence, you can get very close to the male victim. And looking there, I could see them at his feet. Did you use the word them in your answer?
Yes, sir.
On July 5th?
Yes, sir.
And was the last item to which them could have applied in your narrative the word glove?
Singular, yes.
I'm simply asking whether glove, line 14, was the item you were talking about just prior to saying I saw them at his feet.
Them, I was referring to the knit cap and the glove.
Show me anywhere on that page where the knit cap is mentioned. Can you?
That page, no.
No. Okay. You see anything on the prior page, Detective Fuhrman, about the knit cap?
Do you want me to look at the prior page?
Sure. I don't know how you can answer the question without looking. 63.
I do not.
Okay. Page 65, Detective Fuhrman.
Excuse me, Mr.
Bailey. I'm sorry.
The court report needs a change of paper.
Okay. What's that? Page 65, Detective Fuhrman. Line 8. Does that photo, referring to a photo, accurately depict the glove at the location where you saw it? To the best of my recollection, yes. Question. All right. And you didn't actually pick up the glove to examine it, did you? Answer. Not at that time. No. Did you give that answer?
Yes.
At what time did you pick up the glove?
I didn't. I turned the glove over with a pen when I returned to the Bundy scene after being at Rockingham.
And that's what you meant when you said didn't pick up the glove at that time. You had in mind turning it over with a pen?
I believe that was Mr. Ullman's words in the question. I didn't use the word pick up.
But the question was put to you, Detective Fuhrman. He said, and you didn't actually pick the glove up to examine it, did you? And your answer was, not at that time, no. Do you see anything in that answer that refers to turning it over with a pen at any time?
Overall.
Not on that page, no.
You see another page where you indicated that that's what you meant by later picking up the glove?
No, sir.
Overruled. Speaking objection, counsel.
Yesterday, and possibly last week, Detective Fuhrman, you indicated some uncertainty as to when you were notified that one of the victims was, in fact, the ex-wife of O.J. Simpson. Remember that?
Yes, sir.
You said you couldn't quite be sure when you thought that that was the fact.
That the female victim was Nicole Brown Simpson? Yes, sir, I remember.
As you sit there today, what is your best recollection as to when you decided or your superiors decided that this was Nicole Brown Simpson? What time of day?
I would say on June 13th sometime, but I don't recollect when.
1, 2, 3 hours after you got there?
I have no idea, sir.
Is it fair to infer that if you went to notify Mr. Simpson that his wife was dead a little after 5, that you thought she was in fact dead, his ex-wife?
I didn't go there at my direction, so I believe it was assumed, and I believe they were going there to find out anything about her or make a notification.
Page 31, Detective Fuhrman. Question by Ms. Clark at line 4. Were you aware, line 5, were you aware of who one of the, at least the female victim, was at that time? Answer, I was notified that when I was notified at my residence at 105 that morning, I was told that one of the victims was the ex-wife of O.J. Simpson. Did you relay that information to Detective Van Adder? Answer, it was relayed, yes. Now, after you were told at 105 that Nicole Brown Simpson was dead, did you continue to doubt it?
We had no indication, absolutely, that that was the female victim.
Did you challenge Mr. Phillips in any way when he told you she was dead?
There was no challenge involved, sir.
Did you question his assertion as to her identity?
No.
Did you ever question it?
I don't think I would have jumped to the conclusion early into the investigation.
You wouldn't have jumped to the conclusion of the identity of the victim, even though a detective who was your boss told you what it was?
I didn't question it.
Okay. From your perspective, what efforts, if you know, were made to determine Mr. Goldman's identity so that his next of kin could be notified?
I have no knowledge of anything to do with that.
You were not involved in that effort?
No, sir.
Did you have anything to do with notice to the Brown family?
No, sir.
About their daughter? Okay. When did you tell us yesterday that you learned where you were going on the trip to Rockingham? Was it when you were in the car with Phillips and he told you?
There was some conversation if I knew the way up there.
With whom?
Phillips? Sorry. Yes, sir.
Okay, but were you already in the car?
When we knew the purpose? Yes.
Okay. Well, were you in the car when you knew where you were going?
I think it was somewhat simultaneous with getting back to the front of the location and talking to Detective Phillips, Van Adder and Lang directing us to take us up there or something to that effect. I got in the car with Detective Phillips and it was discussed then.
Had you disclosed to either any of the three detectives as of the point you left for Rockingham your prior involvement with the Simpsons?
Yes.
To whom did you describe them and when?
Detective Phillips.
When?
And Detective Phillips asked me if I knew how to get to the Simpson house or the Rockingham house.
That was at 5 in the morning or after?
I think it was a little before that.
That you actually left for Rockingham before 5?
No, we left at 5. You asked me what time the conversation took place.
Slightly before 5, you disclosed to him that you'd had prior involvement.
I said I'd been on a radio call there a long time ago.
Okay. And up to that point, you said nothing about that prior involvement?
No.
Okay. Can we approach her?
All right, ladies and gentlemen, there's something I need to look at before we proceed any further, and given the hour, we're going to take our recess for the lunch hour just a little bit early. Please remember my admonition to you. Don't discuss the case amongst yourselves. Don't form any opinions about the case. Don't conduct any deliberations till the matter has been submitted to you. Do not allow anybody to communicate with you with regard to the case. Detective Fuhrman, you may step down. You're ordered to come back at 1:30. And counsel, let me ask you to remain so we can take a look at this. All right. Counsel, anything we need to take up before we invite the jurors to join us? All right, Deputy McNair, let's have the jurors, please. Gentlemen, welcome back. All right, Detective Fuhrman, would you please resume the witness stand? All right, the record should reflect we've all been joined by our jury panel. Detective Mark Fuhrman is still on the witness stand under cross-examination by Mr. Bailey. Good afternoon again, Detective Fuhrman.
Good afternoon, Your Honor.
You're reminded you're still under oath. Mr. Bailey, you may continue.
Detective Fuhrman, in the course of your career as a patrolman and more recently as a detective, how many people would you say you have questioned with respect to criminal investigations?
In the hundreds, sir.
Hundreds?
If not more.
All right. And has it been your experience that when you are questioning someone that is not being totally candid with you, their version of events may change from telling to telling? Is that your experience?
Are you saying if they're not candid and I know that, then I can expect?
No. Do you learn that because they tell you one thing one time and describe it quite differently another time?
I believe it would depend on the time and when you're questioning them.
Okay, but
the space between those events.
Could be a sign of fabricating, could it?
Possibly.
person who doesn't have a real image in their mind but is describing something that didn't happen, right?
I couldn't speculate on that, no.
That would be speculation?
Yes.
Now, Detective Fuhrman, if you would return to the transcript, and if you would, look at page 21 of July 6th, which is toward the end, the third direct examination.
What page, sir?
21, the second day.
Second day.
In response to a question that began on 20 at line 24, all right, with respect to finding the glove, after you found the glove, what did you do? You saw the glove on the walk, then what did you do? You answered, I continued eastbound on the path that went to the rear of the property. And I spent, I'm not going to say a considerable amount of time, I'm going to say about 15 minutes, looking for a person that could have left that glove there, which indicated somebody was injured. I looked in all the places I believed a human could secret himself or collapse in that area, and then I returned to the front of the residence. And I assume the word secret was meant to be secrete.
Yes.
Okay. Now, here you said that the appearance of the glove convinced you that you were looking for an injured person and not a killer. Would you tell us why that's so?
Well, it could be one and the same.
Could be one and the same?
Yes.
Well, is that what you meant when you said someone who was injured? Either a killer or a victim?
Could be either one.
And why were you looking for someone that was injured based on a glove with a sticky substance on it? What was the clue to the injury?
Well, there was blood evidence on the Bronco.
Okay. So you thought that might have come from a person who was driving the Bronco with an injury?
Possibly.
You had been told that the only one that used the Bronco, according to your own testimony, was Mr. Simpson.
Yes.
You knew, did you not, that Mr. Simpson left town at 11 o'clock, very close there too?
No, I didn't.
You knew that if the glove was connected with the thumb, it had been out there for a long period of time?
Yes.
Okay. And you were looking for places where a human being could secrete himself?
Yes.
All right. So as I take it from your reading of this answer, you're looking for a killer who is injured, who is hiding and may have collapsed.
Or a victim.
Or a victim.
Yes.
Okay. Then this is the search that took you the 15 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, there was some question in your mind earlier today as to whether you had told Detective Van Adder and Lang about your thoughts when you took them down to see the glove. You recall that?
I recall the question, yes.
And you were unsure as to whether you had said anything to them when you were down at the scene of the glove?
Yeah, I don't recall if I did.
Okay. No. Would you look page 22, next one over? Line 20. So then, after taking Detective Phillips down to that area and describing everything that you saw, who did you take next? Detective Van Adder. And did you do the same thing with him? Yes, exactly the same thing. Does that tell you that you in fact gave Van Adder all of the detail you had just given Phillips?
No, I don't think verbal. I would.
Well, I'm stopping the question about this one.
Sustained.
Pardon me?
Sustained. You need to ask him the full question and answer that full colloquy there. relates to the same thing.
All right. So each time you went, you took the detective all the way down to where the glove was and brought them all the way back? Yes. And then did the same with Detective Lang? Yes. Did you take any of the detectives all the way back to the area behind Arnell's room that you described going to yourself earlier? I don't believe so. I described to Detective Phillips, I'm almost positive I did to both the other detectives, I scooted under the air conditioner. Now back to my question. When you said exactly the same to Van Adder as to Phillips, did you mean that you'd said the same things to him?
Objection. Counsel is still under 356. Can I get off?
Wait. 356, correct? All right, overruled.
Would you ask that question again, please?
Yes, when you used the word exactly to describe your tour with Van Adder, did that mean it was essentially exactly the same as the tour with Phillips?
Complete conversation.
I'm not sure I would have meant the verbiage, but describing where I walked, what I saw, what I sensed, yes.
Okay. In other words, you may have said essentially the same thing without using exactly the same words.
No, I didn't say that.
Is that what you meant?
No.
All right. What does exactly mean to you, Detective?
That I don't remember exactly what the conversation was. It seemed to be more lengthy with Ron Phillips. I'm not sure about the other two detectives.
Okay. So that when you said, did you do the same thing with Van Adder? Exactly. That's not what you meant.
Yes, I led him down to the glove and showed him the glove.
Okay. After taking the detectives to view this glove, you went out to the front of the house and you just stood there, correct?
For a few moments, yes.
All right. Now, was it at that point that Detective Van Adder announced that this was now a crime scene, or was it later in the day, as you've told us earlier?
I think there was discussion at that point, but at about that time, we were sent back to Bundy, Detective Phillips and myself.
Well, did Van Adder say, we are going to have to handle this like a crime scene within minutes of seeing the glove that you had pointed out?
Yes, but I think that's different than this is now a crime scene.
Oh, I see. He was speculating about a future decision he thought he might make. Was that your understanding?
Yes.
Okay. What was your condition after you had taken the detectives back to view the glove and when you were standing in front of the building? Was anything unusual going on with respect to you?
I think there was somewhat of an adrenaline rush that I experienced when I was in the rear, and I believe when I was in front of the house, I started realizing that this could have been a match to the glove on Bundy.
When you came out after taking all three detectives down there and telling them it was a match, you suddenly realized that it could be a match?
I didn't tell them it was a match. I got their opinion. And when they had the same opinion...
Didn't you discuss with each detective, in turn, the fact that this glove looked like a match on Bundy?
I'm sure, Detective Phillips, I'm not sure on Van Adder and Lang.
Okay. Then why do you tell us that you are now, after these tours are over, suddenly realizing that there may be a connection and thus experiencing a rush of adrenaline?
No, I was coming down from the adrenaline.
When did this rush start?
When I was going east on the path.
Okay. On line 7 of 24, if you recall this question and this answer, if you follow me, please, do you know approximately what time that was when you heard that discussion referring to the crime scene? Answer, no. After that, I came out front. To be honest with you, I was a little taken back by what had transpired. We didn't enter with any intention of finding anything there, and I just kind of stood out there, and I was really kind of collecting my thoughts. When I found the glove back there on this pathway, I have to admit to you that the adrenaline started pumping, because I really didn't know what was going on. And no matter if I found a victim or a suspect, I still had some type of very serious situation at that time, and I think I was coming down from that a little bit. Question, when you say, quote, the adrenaline, answer, I mean, unquote, you mean from seeing the crime scene? Answer, no. Question, from seeing the glove? Answer, when I found the glove and actually realized this glove was very close in description and color to the glove at the crime scene, my heart started pounding and I realized what I had probably found. When that gets going and you never get a chance to run it off or get rid of it, you get kind of a downtime. And I think I was collecting my, not composure, but my thoughts a little bit out front. Question. So while you were collecting your thoughts and relaxing after your discovery, you heard a discussion going on inside the house. Answer, yes. I walked into the front of the residence, and in the kitchen, Detective Lang and Van Adder were discussing what had been found. I believe Detective Phillips was in there also. And they were discussing, quote, we really have got another crime scene here, unquote. And a search warrant was brought up. Quote, we have to get a search warrant, unquote. Detective Van Adder said that. And I don't know exactly what time that was. Have I read your rather lengthy answer correctly?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, you said, when I found the glove and actually realized this glove was very close in description and color to the glove of the crime scene, can you tell us when that point was within this period?
I testified before several times that when I saw the glove, it looked very similar to the glove on Bundy.
The connection was immediate in your mind?
Yes.
Is that correct?
That connection, that it looked very similar, yes.
Okay. Now, on page 26, Detective Fuhrman, line 16, a question, right. Now, with respect to the excitement you felt in encountering the glove, you realized immediately that this may have broken the case. Answer, I don't think it was excitement. I was caught on a 2-foot path in a poorly lit with a little tiny flashlight by myself with no vest, and I must admit that I think the only reason that I proceeded is I felt more that I might have a victim than a suspect. I don't know why I thought that. Like I said, I did not believe the circumstances would unfold as they did when I led these detectives up to Rockingham. I continued, probably hoping that I could find some answer for this glove or somebody that had been injured or something, but it was more alert than excitement. Did you give that answer?
Yes, I did.
All right. So you described that you were caught on a tiny 2-foot path, all alone, with a little tiny flashlight and no vest, by which you meant a bulletproof vest, correct?
Yes, sir.
Would you explain to this court how it was that you were caught there?
I'm sure I don't understand what
you... don't understand the question.
No, sir.
I'm using your words. I was caught on a 2-foot path in a poorly lit with a little tiny flashlight by myself with no vest. And I must admit the only reason I proceeded is I felt more that I might have had a victim than a suspect. Were you caught or could you have left immediately the way you came in?
I was committed to that point.
Committed how?
Because I was there.
You had nobody with you?
I was committed by my presence. Yeah.
You didn't have anyone with you, did you?
No.
You weren't wearing a vest, you've said?
Yes.
Your flashlight was rather inadequate for the task, right?
It was not the best it could be, no.
But you comforted yourself that you could proceed despite these deficiencies because you thought you would find a victim rather than a suspect.
I was concerned with that, yes.
Tell the court, if you can, why the presence of the other murder glove from Bundy made you think that you were about to encounter a victim, Detective Fuhrman.
Because I didn't have anything to believe that there was a suspect there other than the bloody glove.
Do you realize that you have told us earlier and testified under oath earlier that the bloody glove made you think you would find a suspect?
Or a victim.
But by far the more likely a suspect, you said, did you not?
Yes.
But here you said on your oath the only reason you proceeded unarmed and alone, or at least without a vest and alone, was because you didn't expect to find a suspect. You said that, didn't you?
Yes, I did.
Overruled.
Does that mean that you did not think that you would be in danger if you proceeded eastbound through the cobwebby path because whoever you would find would be hurt and not dangerous?
I don't believe that there was no feeling of danger, no.
But you did say, I must admit, I think the only reason I proceeded is I felt more that I might have had a victim than a suspect.
Maybe that was a hope.
And I'll say that was a hope and not a thought.
No, I'm saying maybe that was a hope. My presence of mind then and at the prelim.
You recall that yesterday we talked about your visit to the what we have called the fence that is on the border of the two properties, 873 and 875.
Yes.
Okay. You called it, I believe, the north border.
At the north border of the residence to the south, yes.
Okay. When you described this experience yesterday, you told us that you were standing, having been relieved, waiting for your replacement at the intersection of Dorothy and Bundy, correct?
We're talking at the Bundy location now?
Yes.
Oh, yes, sir. The north residence from
that
Bundy.
Lieutenant Spangler, your ultimate boss in the Bureau of Detectives, came and brought you up to the fence where Goldman's body was crumpled.
Yes.
Without going through the tape or under it.
That's correct.
There was no tape beyond that end of the fence, was there?
No, that residence was not taped off in the front.
You were able to walk in a little walkway next to the dividing line.
Yes.
But outside the fence.
Yes.
And there, Lieutenant Spangler, having invited you to take a look, you examined Goldman's body and found a laceration.
That was observed by Lieutenant Spangler.
But you saw it too.
Oh, yes, sir.
And you thought it was a tear.
I used the word laceration.
And when I asked you to describe it further, did you not say it was torn?
No, I said laceration is tearing. It's not an incision.
Okay. In any event. And when I asked you if there was anything else that you saw at that point, you said no, didn't you?
Yes.
Okay. Now, on July 5th, at page 64, which we have reviewed, when you described the same incident, there is no mention whatsoever of your having been relieved. Is there? Page 64, Detective Fuhrman.
You're going to have to give me a line, sir.
Okay. Starting at the top, just reading to yourself so that you can locate yourself as you did this morning. On the steps, looking down at the female victim and not being able to clearly see the male victim.
That's correct.
Okay. You said then, line 14, 12. We had flashlights. We were looking at the female victim. We looked at the male victim. You're still in the steps, right?
Yes.
You said, I noticed the glove when I walked around to thee after I exited the residence the first time and walked around to the side on the north side, north perimeter of 875 Bundy. There's an iron fence, and through that iron fence, you can get a very close look at the male victim.
Read it
can
again.
Get very close to the male victim.
Read the whole sentence again.
And looking there, I could see them down at his feet.
Wait,
you read that
wait,
earlier.
Wait. Read it again.
Okay. There's an iron fence, and through that iron fence, you can get very close to the male victim. And looking there, I could see them down at his feet. We read that earlier, you recall?
Yes, sir.
Now, there's nothing in there about your having been relieved, is there?
About being relieved?
Yeah.
Objection.
Objection what? Vague, sustained.
Had you been relieved when this happened?
The question's not here, counsel.
Pardon me, Your
Honor? The question is not here. It's what did you observe there? It's not.
I'm putting another question to him. Had he been relieved before he made this excursion? That's not in the transcript. I'm asking his memory.
Yes.
Okay. Did you tell us yesterday you went here at the request of and with Lieutenant Spangler?
Yes.
Is there anything in this description about Lieutenant Spangler?
It wasn't asked, sir.
Did you tell us yesterday about a laceration?
Yes.
Is there anything in this description about a laceration?
That also wasn't asked.
Well, this is a piece of information that you volunteered. It wasn't in response to any question, was it, Detective Fuhrman?
Sustained.
Was the question which was put to you that triggered this whole answer, when did you first observe it, meaning the glove?
Yes.
And that gave rise to your statement about what you saw from the steps and your tour up to the northern part of the residence and looking through the fence, correct?
Yes.
All right. Now, when you gave this testimony, had you forgotten about the laceration?
No.
Had you forgotten about Lieutenant Spangler?
No.
Okay. Once more then, Detective Fuhrman, we asked you to look at page 49 this morning because of a word that appears on line 23 of that page relating to blood in the Bronco. And you
yes.
agree that that's what the page says?
I agree, sir.
All right. But your feeling was that the reporter made a mistake.
I didn't say that. I just did not mean in the Bronco.
Pardon me? What was your
Would
answer?
Would you ask the question
You're
again,
saying
sir?
The reporter didn't make a mistake, but the word is there somehow.
I don't know. I just know what I meant when I testified.
All right. So that if you, in fact, use the word in, you misspoke yourself?
Yes.
Okay. Can we play that portion of the tape, Your Honor?
Yes.
Talked to the man that was in the bungalow. He's seated at the bar. And I continued out the front of the residence.
Why?
Well, I was, from the statement he made, the crashing sound, and the time that he heard it, combined with the blood in the Bronco.
Is that a fresh memory in any way? It's
what you said on July 5th. Go ahead and play the rest of it to Mr. Harris.
There's a possibility there could be another victim or a suspect that had collapsed or escaped via that route on the southern border of the house.
What?
Does that refresh your recollection?
Absolutely, sir.
Okay. And what do you now say you said?
In.
In.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you. Now, Detective Fuhrman, do you have a financial interest in the outcome of this case?
I do.
Do you?
No, I don't.
Have you not brought claims that you intend to prosecute when this case is concluded for money?
Civil suits?
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely, sir.
All right. Do you know a lawyer whose name is Turtle O, something like that? Turtle
yes, sir.
O?
Yes.
All right, with the court reporter, please. All right, thank you, counsel. Proceed.
Detective Fuhrman, for what purpose did you retain your lawyer, Robert Turtle?
Because I was defamed in the media for planting evidence in a capital crime.
Some magazine or other?
Magazine, radio, TV, personal attacks.
Now, did you authorize your attorney to send a letter to certain of Mr. Simpson's counsel threatening a lawsuit for defamation when this case ends?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you review any such letters before they went?
I don't believe so. I received copies, but I did not review them and approve them, no.
All right. And you were complaining that you had been accused as a result of conduct for which you thought they were responsible of planting evidence in a capital case. Is that right?
The first part of that question I don't think I understand.
You were complaining, as you've just told us, that you were being accused in the media, partly due to their responsibility, these lawyers,
yes,
of
sir.
Planting evidence in a capital case.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And that is a very serious crime, isn't it?
Yes.
Both state and federal.
Yes.
Yes. Okay. Now, when this lawsuit is over, you have an intent to begin a defamation lawsuit of a civil nature against Mr. Shapiro and Mr. Cock, correct?
I believe so, yes.
And to ask a jury for money damages for the damage to your reputation for being accused of planting the glove.
What's the objection? No.
That's as far as I'm going.
It's the nature of the lawsuit, counsel. Overruled.
Is that not your intent?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Now, in addition to that, have you sought to obtain money in any other fashion due to your connection in this case?
No.
Did you authorize Mr. Tortolo to send a letter to various police departments asking for contributions to Mark Fuhrman?
I believe he started a defense fund, yes.
Well, the letter which went to police said Mark Fuhrman needs help, didn't it? There's nothing to do with it. That's what it said, isn't it?
I believe something to that effect.
One of the purposes for which the letter said you needed help was to pay Bob Tortolo $100,000 for advising you, wasn't it?
I don't recall any part of that letter.
Have you ever seen it?
I don't believe I've seen anything that says that.
Has it ever been read to you?
I don't believe so. I don't recall $100,000 to advise me.
Well, $100,000 for fees. Do you remember that part?
No, I don't, sir.
Do you remember any amount that was suggested in the letter of solicitation to help Mark Fuhrman?
No, but if I could see the letter, I would like to.
We'll dig it out for you. Let's turn, if we may, Detective Fuhrman, to the preparation that went into your appearance here last Thursday. Well, I'm asking counsel to dig it out. If we don't have it today, we'll have it in the morning.
All right, proceed. Denied.
I would like to turn, Detective Fuhrman, to preparation. I believe you said that you had not seen any of the prosecutors or their assistants helping them with this case until 1995.
I did not come down to this building for that purpose until this year. That's correct.
That was not my question. My question was, how many times have you spent time with any of the prosecutors in this case relating to your testimony?
Just in 1995.
All right. At no time in all of 1994 did you sit down with any of the prosecutors and talk about what testimony you would give?
Before the prelim, I believe, Marsha Clark and Bill Hodgman sat down with me. They asked what happened. I told them.
After the prelim?
No, not after the prelim.
Okay. Did you get a transcript of your testimony at the prelim, the one that you are seeing in front of you at this moment?
Yes, sir.
When did you first get that?
I believe that was in 1994.
Okay. And can you tell me when?
No.
Well, was it close to the end of the prelim or close to the end of the year or somewhere in between?
I'd probably say somewhere in between.
September?
I don't know, sir. Somewhere in between. Could possibly, yes.
Did you read in the paper this summer that this trial was scheduled to begin on September 19th?
I don't recall, no.
You didn't pay attention to the Simpson case and the newspaper?
I don't read the newspaper.
Don't read the newspaper. Watch TV?
About this case?
Mm-hmm.
Not much, sir.
Listen to the radio?
Yes.
About this case?
About this case? Yeah. It's kind of hard to avoid it.
Okay. Now, that being the case, may we assume that you knew that the trial date had been fixed by law, 60 days from the date of arraignment, or September 19th.
I don't have any personal recollection of that, but I'll agree with it.
Did you feel any need to refresh your recollection as to the story you had told at the prelim during the summer of 1994 and after the prelim?
Sustained. Rephrase the question.
Okay. Do you have a recollection of reading your testimony prior to September 19th?
No, I don't recall, sir.
Have you viewed the videotape of the Mark Fuhrman testimony of July 5th and 6th, 1994, at any time?
At no time.
At other than the snippet that we just looked at a few minutes ago, you've seen no videotapes?
No.
Okay. Now, how about the other witnesses who testified at the prelim? Have you read any of their testimony?
None.
Have you watched any videotapes as to what they said?
No.
Were you watching at the time that they were testifying?
No.
None of them?
No, sir.
At any time?
No.
Okay. How many times would you say you have read that transcript that's before you?
My transcript I probably read through once when I received it, and then certain areas back and forth a few times, I'd say 2-3 times.
How many times have you been through it page by page with one or more of the prosecutors?
Through my transcript?
Mm-hmm.
Never.
Never. Have you discussed the contents of your testimony at the prelim with any of the prosecutors?
Yes, sir.
How many times did you do that?
With the contents of what was testified to at the prelim without the transcript, probably twice.
With whom?
Marcia Clark and Chris Darden.
Were they both present on each of these occasions?
No, it was separate.
Once with one, once with the other?
Yes, sir.
Was there some question at that time as to who was going to handle you as a witness?
Objection.
Irrelevant. Sustained. Although I don't need it from three lawyers at the same time.
How many total times have you met with either Mr. Darden, Ms. Clark, or anyone else in the prosecution team in connection with your testimony?
Seven or eight times.
Seven or eight. Beginning when and ending when?
It'll be various times this year, probably mostly within the last month and a half.
Okay. And when would you do that, in the evening or on the weekend?
Oh, sometimes it was in the late afternoon or evening. And it might be in the weekend.
Were all of those meetings in this building?
Yes.
Okay. And were they all in the offices of the prosecutors?
Not always in the office, no.
Where else did you meet?
We met once in the grand jury room.
Was that to simulate the environment of a courtroom?
I'm not sure if it was that or just the availability of a forum-type setting.
How many times have you testified in court since you became a police officer? A
couple hundred times, I'm sure.
Hundreds?
Yes.
Okay. Did you ever testify as a military policeman before a court-martial?
Yes.
How many times?
Twice, I believe.
Would you say that you are a fairly experienced witness?
I think I've testified numerous times, yes, sir.
How many of the cases in which you've testified have dealt with homicide? Whether you were a patrolman or detective is irrelevant. Just the subject matter.
Dozens.
Dozens?
Yes.
Okay. In how many of those cases were you given preparatory assistance prior to your testimony in a grand jury room, if you can remember?
Never in a grand jury room.
This was a first?
Yes.
Was it explained to you why the offices which had been available on the other occasions were not available that compelled you to go into the grand jury room?
It was not explained, no.
Where did you sit while you were discussing your testimony?
I believe it would have been in the witness chair to the right of the foreman.
You were sitting in the witness chair?
Yes.
Might we say that that was practicing?
Yes.
You've never before prepared to testify for a case by going in a courtroom and sitting in the witness chair, have you?
I don't recall doing that, no.
But as you told us at the very outset of your testimony, this, Detective Fuhrman, is a special case, is it not?
I think it was an important case. The word special case, I haven't heard that.
Didn't you say that people were more concerned with things other than the evidence than they were with the evidence, and that set it apart from the other cases, or words to that effect?
Yes.
Okay. As a result of that, we learned you had some special sessions with some prosecutors, I take it, other than Ms. Clark and Mr. Darden.
Sustained. Phrase question.
How many people were present in the grand jury?
Overall.
Seven, eight.
Seven?
Seven or eight.
How many were lawyers, if you know?
Four or five.
How many questioned you?
There was a lot of discussion going on between them.
How many questioned you, Detective Fuhrman?
I'm trying to get to that, sir.
Okay.
Two, maybe three.
You remember who they were?
Yes. Mr. Darden, Mr. White.
Mr. White, could you help us
yes.
with that one?
Terry White.
Terry White.
And I believe Mr. Yokelson.
Now, with these questions, how long did each one spend with you? Can you help us with that?
Well, it was very brief. There would be a question or a comment, and that would be it.
Was there any record made of this experience, such as tape, audio tape, court reporter, notes, if you know?
I know, and there wasn't.
Okay. Was a script prepared to assist you in delivering your testimony?
No.
Have you seen any script in this case?
A script?
Yes. Q&A.
I've seen questions that might be asked, but I don't have those now.
With whom did you review lists of questions that might be asked?
I didn't review those with anyone. There's questions that were asked, and they were written down, but I don't have a copy of those.
All right. But at some time prior to coming to this courtroom, did you see a written list of questions that you anticipated would be asked?
No.
Have you ever seen a written list of questions that pertains to your testimony?
I've seen questions that people were taking notes of, but as far as a list that this is what we're going to ask you, no.
What did you mean a moment ago when you said you've seen a list of questions?
Well, people are reading questions or talking or discussing in front of me or with me.
Are you looking at questions written on a piece of paper at this time?
No.
Or assuming that they're written on paper because somebody's reading?
Well, I can see that there's writing.
Okay.
And they're making notations in writing.
All right. Now, when you were examined by the three lawyers you have named, what was the nature of their question?
Cross-examination.
These were leading questions and suggestive questions?
I don't think I know what you mean by that, sir.
A leading question is a question that suggests the answer. For instance, you are Mark Fuhrman, not what is your name. You understand
no.
the difference?
I understand the difference, but no, they weren't.
Were any of the questions abusive?
I don't know if I...
Insulting?
No.
Nasty?
No.
What were you told was the purpose of this exercise?
To prepare me for cross-examination.
Okay. And what were you to guard against in cross-examination that this preparation would facilitate?
I don't think I was told.
Sustained.
Were the questions that were being put to you as simulated cross-examination, in your mind, an attempt to assist in preparing you to withstand a real cross-examination?
No. I think there are areas and questions that have probably never been asked most detectives or policemen.
Can you give me an example?
No, I can't.
Can you think of any language that was used in those questions that some might find offensive, Detective Fuhrman?
No.
None?
No.
Can you remember even one of the questions that these three lawyers put to you?
No, I do not, sir.
Not a single one?
No.
May we then assume that you did not profit by the experience of preparation for cross-examination?
I don't think it was very productive, no.
Was there any effort on your part to reach certain goals as a result of this training session?
I don't understand that question, sir.
Did you start out, before the lawyers started in on you with their questions, with an objective in mind, something you wanted to achieve that would make you a better witness?
No.
Did not?
No.
Did they describe for you any objective that they had in mind that you should reach in order to be a better witness?
I don't recall they did, no.
When did this take place?
A few weeks ago.
What day of the week?
I want to say it was a Saturday or a Sunday.
The weekend, wasn't it?
Yes, I'd probably go on Sunday.
And who are the people there that you have not named, if you know?
I don't know a lot of the people by name.
Can you classify them?
Well, I know the ones I do know by name was Mr. Yokelson, Mr. Darden, Miss Lewis, Mr. White, Mr. Yokelson.
You named him?
Yes.
Okay,
I'm just going
forward.
I'm going through all of them.
Okay.
Mr. Runyon, and I don't know the names of a lot of the other people that were there, or the rest of the people.
Were they detectives or lawyers, if you know?
I'm not sure. I didn't know the status of some of the people.
Were they participating in the discussion?
I don't believe they were, no.
Were they suggesting questions, if you remember?
No. They appeared to be observers.
Right. Now, Detective Fuhrman, this is a one and only in your experience as a witness, isn't it?
Excuse me, sir?
This grand jury adventure, where you were given trial cross-examinations by three different lawyers, that's the only time in your career that's ever happened, isn't it?
Yes.
Did they tell you there was something that they were trying to prevent from happening in your cross-examination?
No.
Has that ever been discussed?
Prevent? No.
All right. Well, we were told right at the outset of your testimony that you had had the special training. Is there anything more that you can tell us about what you did or what they did?
They were discussing a lot of things between themselves, and it lasted 20 or 30 minutes, and it wasn't very productive. I didn't get much out of it.
Right. Was any of it designed to help you keep your temper, if you know?
No.
It was not?
No.
Was any of it designed to help you to avoid the use of certain language, if you know?
No.
It was not?
No.
It sounds as if you really don't have any idea what the purpose was. Is that a fair statement?
No, it was for cross-examination, but it was very casual. I was eating a submarine sandwich at the same time the discussions were going on.
I take it this was less than blistering, this cross-examination that permitted you to munch away on a submarine.
Yes, as I said, it was a discussion between the attorneys. And
sounds more like a luncheon.
You really do need to let him finish the question.
Yes, Your Honor. Can you tell me, just yes or no, were any racial slurs used in that experience that day?
No, they weren't.
Not a single one?
No.
Didn't hear one spoken all day in the room?
No.
Okay. Can you then relate this grand jury room session to what you were trying to explain to us at the outset of your direct examination?
I think the attorneys were concerned with cross-examination of myself, and there was discussion and somewhat of meeting of minds and hoping that we could prepare me for cross-examination. I don't think it achieved those goals.
But you said, Detective Fuhrman, that your concerns had nothing to do with the crime scene or the murder. They were something else.
Yes.
All right. What were the concerns, Detective Fuhrman?
Well, there's been numerous motions to bring in irrelevant evidence into this trial.
Irrelevant evidence.
Yes, sir.
Such as?
Sorry, I was trying to communicate with my clerk there. Hold on.
What irrelevant evidence was going to be brought into the trial that you were preparing for?
Approach with sidebar, please. Room. All parties are present. Detective Fuhrman is still on the stand. Mr. Bailey, the question you asked was what irrelevant evidence was going to be brought into the trial that you were preparing for. Is that correct?
Yes. May I respectfully point out, Your Honor, that that question was triggered by the witness' prior answer, that the preparation was connected with the irrelevant material that he'd heard offered in court.
All right.
Okay. Now,
courts are always wary of things that are irrelevant.
When decided by witnesses that they're irrelevant.
All right. Let's see what the answer to this question is going to be.
Detective Fuhrman, what events did you have in mind when you spoke of irrelevant occurrences that you feared might be brought into court?
Kathleen Bell.
All right. And you say that that's irrelevant?
Yes.
Even though you knew that the judge ruled that it could be relevant, did you not?
Object to that.
Overruled. No, Mr. B, I'm not interested in this other business. I'm interested in what irrelevant incidents we're talking about. The rest of it will come later.
Okay. Did this fear strike you before or after you read about certain rulings by the court in January?
Mr. Bailey, the only thing I'm interested in is what irrelevant, what items, what issues, what events Detective Fuhrman thought were irrelevant that he was prepared for.
Fine. Do you understand the question as framed by the court?
Yes, sir.
Can you answer?
Yes. It's still Kathleen Bell.
Had you any concern about any other individuals under the umbrella of irrelevant that might find their way to the trial?
No.
No.
All right. That's what I was afraid, that we were going to get something beyond Kathleen Bell. Apparently not. That's an issue that we're familiar with, the jury's familiar with at this point. Anything else? I told the jury I'd give them enough for a comfort break. Jeffy, why don't you check and see if they're available? Go ahead and take a stretch if you like. All right, let's keep it quiet in the courtroom. We're going to await the jurors' availability. But go ahead and stand and stretch if you like. Record to reflect, we've been rejoined by all the members of our jury panel. Mr. Bailey, you may continue.
Thank you, Your Honor. Detective Fuhrman, when you said earlier that you were concerned about matters that you viewed as irrelevant, would you tell the court specifically which person you had in mind, which incident?
Yes, Kathleen Bell.
Okay. Now, are you telling us then, and did you know prior to this trial any other claims that were made against you of a type similar to Kathleen Bell, prior to taking the witness stand?
What's the objection? Overruled. You can answer that question, yes or
just
no.
Just yes or no is all I want.
Yes.
Either. Okay. But was Kathleen Bell the focus of your concern?
Yes.
And were the questions that were put to you by two prosecutors focused on the Kathleen Bell problem?
Yes, I believe so.
Two of these prosecutors prosecuted Rodney King, didn't they?
I did not know that until I was told.
You did not know that?
Wait. Let him finish the answer, Mr.
Sorry, Your Honor.
I had known that Terry White was, but I didn't recognize Mr. Yokelson's name.
All right. In any event, that was the purpose of the exercise, the bell problem, and you did not feel that it was productive, correct?
I didn't feel it was really a useful exercise, no.
Okay. And you still don't know what their objective was in doing this, is that right?
Well, I assumed it was preparation.
Preparation for what?
Cross-examination, sir.
About Kathleen Bell?
Yes.
About certain language that some find offensive?
Yes.
Okay. And your concern about that, then, is what led to this tripartite simulated cross-examination, correct?
Sustained. Calls for facts, not evidence. It's speculation.
Free lawyer cross-examination in the grand jury room, correct?
Yes.
You recall on Thursday when you took the stand that almost immediately at the outset of your testimony, Ms. Clark displayed for you a part of a copy of a letter that had been sent by Kathleen Bell to Johnny Cochran sometime in 1994.
Yes, I did.
Had you ever looked at the entire letter rather than just that part?
No, sir.
Had you ever seen that letter before you came into this courtroom?
No.
Had you ever reviewed its contents with anyone before you came into this courtroom?
No.
Did you have any idea that Ms. Clark was going to begin your testimony by throwing the Bell letter up on the screen?
I knew the contents, but I had never read the letter.
No. Did you have any idea that your testimony would begin by putting the accusations of Kathleen Bell up on the screen?
No, I didn't.
Was that a surprise to you when she did that?
The letter, yes.
Was it a surprise to you when she developed in your testimony that you had had some practice sessions somewhere?
That wasn't a surprise, but I didn't know how it would be phrased.
Okay. Now, Your Honor, I have 102, People's 102, I guess it is. Could you start at the top of the Elmo, Mr. Harris? And tell me right at the top of the letter, not that page, please.
Items that are on there, Mr.
Harris. Your Honor, a voice concerned about a certain subject.
All right.
All right. Right at the top, please. Begins, dear Mr. Cochran. All right. My understanding is, Detective Fuhrman, you have never held in your hand a piece of paper on which these words are written. You've only discussed it.
That's correct.
Now, you notice in the second paragraph, it says that the author glanced up at the television and was quite shocked to see that Officer Fuhrman was a man that I had the misfortune of meeting. You were on television prior to this summer in connection with this case, were you not?
Yes.
And your testimony as a witness, you learned, was quite widely watched in this state and others, did you not?
Yes.
Okay. You notice that the author says that she has left a message on Mr. Cochran's answering service.
Yes.
Okay. Next paragraph, Mr. Harris. Between 1985 and 1986, she says she worked as a real estate agent in Redondo Beach for Century 21 Bob Maher Realty, now out of business, period. Number one, when you were at the recruiting station, did you become acquainted with a Century 21 real estate office located proximate to the recruiting station?
Did I become
familiar with the fact that there was such an office?
I think there was one on the second floor. Yes.
Did you have to go through the office to get to it, or were there separate stairs?
I don't remember that at all.
Was there a coffee shop close by to these two offices?
A coffee shop in that small shopping area?
Yeah.
Not that I remember, no.
You don't. Okay. Did you ever determine whether or not in 1985 and 6 a Kathleen Bell had been employed at the office described in the letter?
Confirm that she had been employed there?
Yeah.
I never knew a Kathleen Bell,
no.
But no.
Did you ever make inquiry after you learned of this letter to find out whether there was a Kathleen Bell employed, as she says, at that time at the Century 21 office?
I did not.
Did you cause your lawyer, Mr. Turtelow, to do that?
No, I didn't.
And did you cause your investigator, Mr. Pelicano, to do that?
No.
It's Pelicano. You know how
Pelicano?
We all know how it's pronounced.
I see. All right. Did you cause him to do that?
No.
Okay. To this day, do you know whether or not that part of the claim is truthful, that she worked at Century 21 in 85 and 86?
Yes, I know that she does.
Okay.
Or did, I'm sorry.
Do you know whether or not she was known to the Marines that you met when you went to the recruiting station on several occasions?
Then or now?
Do you now know?
Yes.
And the fact is, she was known to them, correct?
Yes.
All right.
Overruled.
And you say that on one occasion, a woman whose description you cannot dredge up in any detail may have been in the office, and you're unable to say whether or not that was or was not Kathleen Bell. Is that correct?
That's correct.
All right, next paragraph. At the top, please. In 1985 or 86, were you a police officer in Westwood?
I worked the footbeat, yes. In Westwood, yes.
So that if she heard you say that, that was the truth. Correct?
Speculation sustained.
Were you a person who, while in the Marine Corps, had been in some kind of special division?
No.
All right. Did you serve in Vietnam at all?
Not in country, no.
Not in country?
I was on a ship.
Okay. But it was called being stationed in Vietnam, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Did you say, while in the recruiting station, at any time during those years, that when you see a nigger driving with a white woman, you pull them over?
No.
Do you recall anyone asking you, if you didn't have a reason to pull them over, what would you do?
I don't recall anybody ever asking me that question, sir.
Did you ever make the statement that if you needed a reason, you would find one?
No.
Okay. Next paragraph. Did you say at any time in that recruiting station, in the presence of any female, including Kathleen Bell, that you would like nothing more than to see all niggers gathered together and killed?
No.
All right. Are you aware, bottom of the page, of any complaint that was brought to the LAPD by this individual?
I'm not aware of any investigation, okay. No.
But you are aware that she has appeared on public television and made essentially these same claims, correct?
Yes.
Have you started any lawsuits against her?
No.
Have you brought claim against her for defamation?
No.
I see. All right. Now, you told us yesterday that you do not know, as I understand it, an Andrea Terry.
That's correct.
Can you recall at any time a blonde woman suggesting that she had an attractive but tall friend?
No.
You recall at any time in the presence of Joe Foss being asked by a woman if you were interested in a date?
No.
That never happened that you can recall?
No.
Is it the kind of thing that you would remember if it had occurred, being asked for a date in the presence of Joe Foss?
I think in the presence of anybody, if I was interested in the woman or it went farther than that, I think I would probably remember it.
Let's assume you weren't interested. Said, hey, you're not my type. Brushed her off. Would you remember being invited on a date if it had happened there?
I would say not.
Okay. Would you remember, Detective Fuhrman, if you had used the language that we have just reviewed?
Yes.
That is important enough language to you so that it would impress itself on your memory, as did the meeting with the Simpsons in 85. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. You told us yesterday that you do go into Hennessy's Tavern.
Yes, sir.
You do not have a recollection of the name Andrea Terry being there?
All right, we're on Andrea Terry now?
Yes, yes.
Right. Mr. Harris?
Take it down. You don't remember the name Andrea Terry, a woman over 6 feet high, or a woman in the company of someone you now know to be Kathleen Bell?
No, I do not.
Did you have a conversation in 85 and 86 in Hennessy's Tavern with a tall woman wherein you said that black men who have white women in their company are violating an act of nature?
No.
And that you would arrest them whenever you saw that occur?
No.
That did not occur at any time?
No.
And is that the kind of language or expression, Detective Fuhrman, that you would remember clearly if those statements had been made?
Yes.
So as of the moment, you would say that if either Kathleen Bell or Andrea Terry claims that you made those statements, that would necessarily be false?
Yes.
And that if Joe Foss, the Marine, says that he in fact introduced you to Kathleen Bell outside the recruiting station as she emerged from a coffee shop, and that the two of you talked about a date, that would necessarily be false?
That's correct.
Document we were discussing that you sent for some time ago of an in-camera nature. If you have it on the bench, I can't locate mine. Maybe we could approach or have a question about it.
All right, why don't you approach without the court reporter, please?
I'm sorry. We approach the man.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to take our recess for the afternoon at this time. Please remember my admonitions to you. Don't discuss the case amongst yourselves. Don't form any opinions about the case. Don't allow anybody to communicate with you regarding the case. Do not conduct any deliberations until the matter has been finally submitted to you. And we'll stand in recess until 9 o'clock tomorrow morning. Detective Fuhrman, you're ordered to return tomorrow morning, 9 o'clock. Thank you, sir. All right, you may step down. All right, we'll stand in recess.